So I get home, excuse me, I get home, and there's that little bird shows up on a branch right in front of me, looking through the windshield. He says, "Hi," and he says, "Hi, I'm here." It jumps up on another little branch, then jumps up to a higher one, jumps on the, and it gets right on top of this branch that's going up. He's looking at me like this, "You get it?" And he says, "Ah, you want me to tape, huh?" And it says, "Yeah," and then it disappears, flies away. I said, "Wow, I got a new little taskmaster, the bird, and I don't want to tape because I feel terrible. I have like a spiritual hangover from the previous video, which I haven't been sleeping. I haven't slept the last 2 nights. It's terrible, and I'm exhausted. But the last video, just I was really exhausted after that because it was such a breakthrough. And again, the pacing of it all is what's really important, is how do you pace yourself when you're going through very intense information. But I'm really tired, but the bird wants me to tape." So I said, "Okay, bird, you know, you're the new taskmaster here. Maybe it'll show up here, but it's in the house somewhere." Amazing timing, right? So there's, when you I'm paying the price for making a big breakthrough, and this is what has to be realized. This is like the trail of the cross, the way of the cross. You suffer for your success, for sure. Wow, really, you feel despondent. I feel like despondent today because all my spiritual certainty seems to have been temporarily swept away. I said, "Oh my gosh, I see it in a new light," and it takes a while to reorient to the new landscape. This is the wow, full stop in the wow. Practice is there's a new landscape, so let's not push ourselves or judge ourselves too harshly while we're, you know, getting used to this new landscape. I die every day. Every day I have a new perspective that's better. But it's tiring. It really is. But we need a new perspective to really put it all together. And I was putting it all together this morning. I saw how death fits into it. It's an excuse that spirit uses for failure. It blames human death, or the death of form, for its failure, for the failure of form to produce a new quality in spirit, which is the spirit wants a quality for it, for the hallucinator to be hallucination also. So it can completely change what it is. So it can absolutely change what it is. And it, since it can't do that, it projects a dream and says that these dream figures can do it. And for example, humans. So it's dreaming of human beings, and spirit tells in a dream, animates the dream as such that it believes that human beings can produce this quality, this ability that translates into the hallucinator also being a hallucination. So spirit changing what it is. Spirit can hallucinate, but the hallucinator isn't a hallucination. It's still spirit. So spirit is dreaming this dream of a universe of worlds, and it never works. However, spirit hides this fact and says, "Well, if so and so hadn't died, they would have got it. But they died. Ah, oh, what a pity!" Right? Do you get that? Do you get that? I asked this morning. I woke up at 4 a.m. I said, "You know, Holy Spirit, you know, still we got to tie in death with all this, right? That's important." And I said, "I know you can do it." And bam, it did it. It was amazing. I said, "Yeah, it's just an excuse spirit's using, like, okay, so and so, well, they almost had it, didn't quite get it, and if they hadn't have died, they would have gotten it, but you know, they died, too bad." See that? So spirit can always say it almost has it. And by the way, spirit always says that it almost has it. Why? Because it's hallucinated the absence of reality, but there's just one little area that is still problematical. So spirit always says, "I'm really close. I'm really close to. All I have to do is now. I have to be the hallucinator. Has to also be hallucination. But that's just a small little thing. The rest is all taken care of." So spirit always has this feeling that it's really close. It just hasn't quite got there yet. And shucks, you know, I almost got there, but so they die. They keep dying on me. Everything keeps dying. Yeah, but spirit's imagining this death. It's all a game to hide from itself what it's really trying to do, what's really going on, and to deny the fact that it cannot change what it is. It says, "No, You almost got it. Keep working. You almost have it. Spirit says, you almost have it. But they say, Spirit, I'm dying. You know, I'm getting old and dying. He said, no, come on, you can get it. I said, I don't know. And then Spirit will have you die and then say, oh, what a great effort. You almost got it. Not quite. Unfortunately, you died. And I'll have to go over and get someone else to do it. Or I'll give you another try at it, like that. This is what's going on. Isn't this amazing new perspective? It's extraordinary new perspective. It's not what Spirit expects. So it throws it for a loop. Spirit says, I don't know how to deal with this. Well, great. That's good. But temporarily, we are like, wow. Shocking. Spirit's kind of used to all the non-dual talk these days. So, but we're giving it a totally new spin, aren't we here? It's not used to this at all. So it really throws it off balance. Spirit's trying to change what it is. It's trying to be the creator of a new reality, which means it'd have to change what it is. And we are Spirit. So we're critical of what we're doing. We're admonishing you. What we're doing is arrogant. It's wrong. We need to relinquish it. And we get help on this by the Holy Spirit, which is the blessing upon our spirit that reminds us exactly what we are and never loses sight of that fact in any way. So we're not hating on ourselves. We're just being honest with ourselves and say, this is the dynamic that is at play here. Wow. So I got death. I got the understanding of that. Say, oh yeah, it's an excuse. And if you give up trying to change what you are, Spirit gives it up. It doesn't even need a body at all, but it certainly doesn't need a body to die, because it's not relying on the body to do the impossible, so it doesn't have to make it the excuse of death for failure. You see how that works? Amazing. So simple. So simple. So then I said, okay, it's easy, so I have it. And what stepped up is the final defense? Absurdity, of course. And instead of fighting with absurdity, I just said, you know what? I'm going to practice saying, I'm experiencing the end of absurdity. I'm experiencing the end of absurdity. Wow. And it's more here and now than expected. Wow. I'm experiencing the end of absurdity, and it's more here and now than expected. So what I'm saying and suggesting to all of us here is, instead of saying, I'm enlightened, I'm realized, I have the peace of God, blah, 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 say, I'm experiencing the end of absurdity. See, we don't expect to hear that, right? Nobody ever says that. I'm experiencing the end of absurdity, which is more here and now than expected. And a matter of fact, the ending of absurdity has to be here and now. Because there's nowhere that absurdity can really go at all. So the only way to end absurdity is see it ending here and now. That's the end of it. To entertain absurdity is to believe it can do, actually go somewhere, do something. It can't. It can't. It doesn't go anywhere. It's never gone anywhere, absurdity. It's always been right here, right now. So that's where the end of it must be also, right? If something's never gone anywhere, to see its ending point, you realize it's right there, right here, right now. Absurdity's never gone anywhere. It's always been right here, right now. So the end of it is also right here, right now. So the only way we can experience the end of absurdity is experience that right here, right now. So the end of absurdity is more right here, right now than expected. Wow. So this is the practice I'm using today. The end of absurdity is right here, right now, more than expected. Wow. The end of absurdity feels right here, right now, more than expected. Wow. The end of absurdity feels right here, right now, more than expected. Wow. Okay, very, very powerful. So I'm adjusting to the insights of the previous days. It's just like a tidal shift. Like, my gosh, nothing's really quite the same. It'll never be the same. And I'm seeing how it generalizes and fits in and explains. It explains so much. It's so amazing. And the fact that it is such this great change explains why I'm so tired. One of the reasons I'm like, boy, it's very stressful. But these times we're in are giving us a big push. Now, I'm not having a very good summer at all. Having a very lousy summer. Not the summer I wanted. It's slipping away yet already. 2 months of it are already gone. This is crazy. I haven't played golf even one time this summer. I haven't done anything this summer. I haven't been in a pool, nothing. I've just been pushing, you know, as intensely as I can on this spiritual, on this practice we're doing, on this focus, on towards experiencing the end of absurdity, which is more, feels more here and now than expected. Wow. That's it. And not sleeping much of the time for my efforts. And then working out physically, which I overdid last week. I'm paying a severe price for that. Wow. But other than that, nothing. Nothing, 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 nothing. So, gosh, gone are the good old days, the lazy, hazy days of summer for me. It used to be so wonderful, the lazy, hazy days of summer. You just, you know, that's just, you know, have popsicles and go swimming, and just the pace is so nice, slow pace. You know, nowhere in particular to go. We don't have to be anywhere on time in particular. You know, this got to go to school, got to be on time, which always freaked me out. I became obsessed with being on time because I really, if I didn't, I wouldn't be on time. I'd just forget, you know. So I love those lazy, hazy days of summer. And we still got a couple months of it really here, but the best August, but I don't know, no prospects at this point. No prospects are coming up yet to do anything at all. But, you know, who knows? That should change. It should change. The eclipse that's coming up, right? Very important. A friend of mine just got hit in his eye with a baseball, and he's been in the hospital, and his eye, he has no vision in the eye yet. When the doctor first shined a flashlight straight in his eye, he said, "I don't see anything. It's just completely black." And right now he's seeing a little bit of light around this big, he looks and he sees this big black ball there. And he's seeing a little bit of light around the edges. So the doctors say he may regain his sight. Oh my gosh. He was just playing a softball game after work. And looked up and this ball came out of the sky and smashed him right in the eye because the lights got in his way. Interesting. I'm in this store today. Then there's this African-American, very nice young man waiting on me. And Jimi Hendrix, All on the Watchtower, began playing. They had some, you know, Sirius XM, I don't know what it is, but they had some, you know, radio playing various songs. And I said, I wonder if he knows what this song is, or he knows it. I asked him, have you ever heard this song before by Jimi Hendrix? And he says, huh? No, I've never heard of it. You don't know Jimi Hendrix? No, I don't know anything about it. I said, wow. I said, it was a very, very, very famous song in the 60s. But I said, you know, I don't blame you because I can't tell you even one artist of today, you know, or maybe Justin Bieber, Taylor Swift. Never heard their music. They're just, you know, famous enough, I guess, you know, heard the name once or twice. The Beliebers, you know. But no, I've never listened to any of the music. So it's not surprising he's never listened to Jimi Hendrix. You know, but I just wondered, you know, if they had any pride, you know. Jimi Hendrix being an African-American, you know, he was, you know, extraordinary. He was a source of artistic pride back then. And he was mellow, not unlike the Black Panthers, who, you know, which back then in the 60s, you know, it was very hostile sort of situation, to say the least. Yeah, but Jimi Hendrix was like somebody that the white Caucasians could feel. We could relate to Jimi Hendrix. He was like a very beautiful, mellow, artistic type of soul, and we loved Jimi Hendrix. He's, you know, he was a genius. So it was really shocking to realize that he was, you know, he was oblivious to Jimi Hendrix. I was like, wow, that's amazing. And then he shook my hand when he left. He shook my hand. He's like, "Yeah, I'll see you next time." And you know, there's some, like, you know, we made some sort of like connection there. Like, you know, it was beyond the superficial in some way, because you know, he sort of felt that way. Like, I hear some older guy, but he's you know, there's a connection beyond age, and age and race and demographics and background and everything else. And he said, "It's interesting, interesting." Willing to, you know, relate in a slightly different way. I try to, but it's so difficult these days. I try to talk to people, and people are so preoccupied with internal grumpiness. It's like it's almost impossible, which really freaks me out. And I'd like to. Can we get a dialogue in public? Like, we, you know, we used to be able to. You meet somebody, your age. "Hey, what's going on?" And yeah, and you just. You're a stranger and you make friends with them, you know, just when you meet them. I mean, how can you make friends if everybody's a stranger at one point, right? But if you try to reach out to people these days, no, you know, just they talk about their dogs or something. Speaking of that, I went to a house today and they had this dog there, and the dog loves to play. You know, it's super fast, athletic. Chase this. And it's, you know, hyper, throw me the ball. Oh, chase it, come back, throw me the ball. And then I realized how non-dharmic that is, because what we want is to avoid the excitation, which leads to delirium, which is what the Holy Spirit wants us to do. And having dogs around is a really bad idea. And I saw it. I said, "Oh my gosh, yeah." Along with music, most music, really bad idea. You could see how dharmic culture is inspired by the Holy Spirit to help us avoid the worst of it here, for sure. Do not allow yourself to be driven into delirium, or try to be an object that induces delirium, okay? And so we have to be very, very mindful of our surroundings and the atmosphere and the excitation that's around it. And we want it to be, the excitation to be really low, really, really low excitation. And you don't want to be referencing bodies and genders and romance and special relationship or anything like that. Because that's the Spirit's bread and butter, is trying to get humans to produce this ability for Spirit. See, Spirit thinks that humans are its salvation, that it can, humans can produce some ability that enables Spirit to be hallucination. It's like we're human beings are supposed to be able to cause Spirit to become just a hallucination. But it doesn't work. But Spirit says, no, there's a way to make it work. Well, it has to say there's a way. And so Spirit has to get humans to interact in such a way as it feels that this will induce this capacity to be created in humans. So it's looking for this sort of transcendent creation in humans, which will then be turned towards Spirit and goes back towards Spirit. And in going back towards Spirit, to Spirit, like a closed loop, so to speak, it will cause Spirit, the hallucinator, to also be a hallucination. This is what Spirit's doing, trying to do. This is what it's trying to do. And we're not used to hearing this so clearly presented at all. It's very shocking and, you know, cause a spiritual hangover. And we know that that's the price we pay. So, but we cannot tarry, you know, at this point and get lethargic, because Spirit is ready to push all the buttons. It's like Spirit says, "I created you, bodies, human beings, and in return for my creating you, I created you with the capacity to develop the special ability to actually transform your creator." Well, of course, Spirit claims that God created Spirit with the ability to transform God. So it's the same thing, isn't it? Spirit says, "I created you human beings with the ability to transform what I am." And what you're going to be able to do is to make the hallucinator also an hallucination. Spirit's hallucinating the absence of reality, but it cannot turn itself into hallucination. And so Spirit feels that this is a dream, really, but spirit feels that humans have this obligation to spirit, and this is that their purpose is to really do the impossible. And so it's trying to push this dream so that it happens for spirit, you know, that humans finally, get this ability. Somehow the pressure is sufficient, the inducement is sufficient, so that suddenly, somewhere, humans begin to, they have this ability. Spirit say, oh yeah, finally. See, I'm a real true creator now. Yeah. Independent, separate creator. But this will never happen. However, spirit believes it will happen if it just pushes the right buttons. So right now, it's set up a lot of buttons to push, and it's getting ready to push them. Let alone the watchtower. You know, two riders were approaching, and the wind begins to howl. All along the watchtower, they're keeping their watch. What's approaching? Something ominous, and the wind begins to howl. It's like that song has always been very evocative. Like, of course, it's written by Bob Dylan, the lyrics. Maybe poetic foresight, right? So, who knows how many buttons spirit's going to push? So, but the ultimate aim again is to try and push enough buttons to bring about human beings suddenly mutating in some way into this, having this ability to change, quote unquote, their creator. But, it's like saying dream figures, have the ability to change the dreamer of the dream figures, which is, absurd. Dream figures don't have the ability to change the dreamer at all. The dreamer is never actually a dream figure, a true dream figure. It never becomes the dream. It's always the one who's dreaming the dream. The dream is not dreaming the dreamer. Okay, the dream cannot dream the dreamer and turn the dreamer into just a dream. The dreamer always remains the one that is dreaming. Now, this is really basic stuff, but we have to keep going over it. Well, it's the afternoon, and we got to pace ourselves here. Pace ourselves. So we're going over fairly familiar territory. We're just adding some clarity to it. And I saw why war happens. Also, I saw that. I said, "Oh gosh, okay, of course." That's part of the delirium that is built up as spirit's trying to produce a delirious attraction. So males are supposed to have this irresistible attraction to females, and females are supposed to be this irresistibly provoke this delirious attraction. And in doing so, it's supposed to transmute the females, feeling that they're irresistible. It's supposed to cause this transmutation in females, and then to give birth to this ability. Now, the way that the form-based situation is, they give birth to babies. The idea is that the babies they give birth to have this ability to change spirit, to cause spirit to be nothing but an hallucination. But the way that this is supposedly done is only if the women prove to be irresistibly attractive and the men are completely delirious with attraction, and the spirit hopes that this brings about a new race capable of changing spirit. You heard about the new root races, the new races in the new age, and they'll have this abilities. Well, that's spirit's dream. That's the hope of spirit, that they have this capacity to actually change spirit. And so spirit is going to go all in to try to bring this about, this new root race that it believes will have these abilities. Call it whatever you want. And so it's going to push a lot of buttons to bring about this. One of them is war. In wartime, I remember I read this diary of a German soldier in France. It was a young man, and he's very observant, and he just said, "Holy cow." He says, "War changes everything." He says, the women here just absolutely throw themselves at you, the French women, like there's no tomorrow. And he says, you walk down the street and they just basically assault you. He said, it's unbelievable. It completely changes their psychology, he says. And, well, what is it? The intensity. They believe that here's this German soldier and he's going off, going off to war maybe tomorrow. He's going to be killed. And so, here's his final chance to experience what they call, quote-unquote, life to its fullest. That he should be, deliriously attracted, and that this intensity of his, of his situation about to die might produce a baby that has this transmutational qualities that spirit's looking for. This is spirit. This is the game of spirit. And so when there is death, war flying around the world, that this causes this super intensity in the special relationship. And women, the psychology drastically changes. I mean, he explained it in an amazing way that he said it was really actually utterly astounding to him. Bewildering, actually, he said. It's bewildering. He said, how can they be like this, Why? I don't get it. Well, we understand now. We're finally getting it, the dynamic. And so wars are one of the ways that spirit tries to bring about this transmutation that can, some ability to transform, to change spirit, and to make the hallucinator a hallucination. So it hopes that there's some way to produce humans that have this ability. And so it goes towards extreme romance, extreme intensity, like you're about to die, or extreme threat, or extreme attraction, extreme beauty, trying to attract, drugs, music. It tries to create this atmosphere where there's this super intensity, super commitment, super intensity, transformative feeling, and then this hopes that the next generation, the children from this, will have this transformative ability in them. So it tries to sculpt this capacity through culture and the events of culture. So it pushes buttons. It causes, it's dreaming this whole thing. It dreams up a war. It dreams up danger. It dreams up death, especially for men. Of course, you if you have the intensity of death and the man's someone about to die, you can't have the woman die because she's the one that has to have the baby. So of course it has to be the men who are in threat of dying to bring about what the hope for intensity. And so you look back in history you realize, oh, this is what history's been about. You see the play of culture, the play of civilization, so much bloodshed, war, and threat, and vulnerability throughout the whole history on this planet. And generally, before men go off to war, all the women get pregnant. Or when they're on leave, and that's the to replace the men that they're going to die. But of course spirit says, look, well, these men, they don't quite have the transformative quality, so but I can't admit that. So I said they could have succeeded, but they died, but it's too bad. But maybe the next generation will have it. It's very, very cynical, isn't it? Picture, but it's a very true picture, actually. So it's difficult to accept this, just how rotten this whole dream is, actually. But you have to have a sense of humor about it. It's It's so rotten, it's funny, you know. But when you see it, you say, oh, good, I'm getting free of this. So it's not too bad. You go through this period where you're ignorant of it, and it's not, you think it's not too bad, but something isn't right. Then you start figuring out what's wrong, and that's pretty awful time. And then now you look at it and say, well, I'm getting, the Holy Spirit is freeing me from this, so, you know, it's not, I'm not going to be caught up in this nonsense much longer, that's for sure. So it's not too bad. But initially, it's quite a shock just to see what's really going on with this world. A place where, again, it's a good excuse to die. Well, you need to die because there's not enough room here in this world. You know, like, so limited resource, limited space. There's another excuse for dying. Well, everything has to die here because everything has to die because there's not enough room. You know, we can't have everything living. We're out of space. And then it says, but through dying, you know, they failed. But if it hadn't died, I would have succeeded. It's just a way for spirit again to excuse itself for. To avoid seeing that it's impossible what it's trying to do. It's saying, so I almost got it, but you know, this world's making it tough. Right, this world's making, so it imagines this universe full of these stars and planets with these various forms, process of forms moving about, working on trying to get this transformation, and we're the experience that we're aware of at this point is you know, more the, you know, human being experience, identifying with that aspect of the dream. It's a useful one to look to go through because they say that it's the one that's most spirits most likely to be able to wake up, realize that the insanity of it all, is identifying, hoping that humans can do it for spirit. And again, spirit's doing everything of the dream. The dreamer is dreaming all of the dream. There's not, the dream figures aren't dreaming any of the dream. But the dream is dreamed in such a way as to seem that they are. See, this is the cleverness of the dream. Is spirit's dreaming, imagining all this, but it also imagines that some of the imaginary figures are also doing their own imagination. But it's not true. Spirit's doing all of it. 100% of it. And you know, just hearing this, we don't need to quite understand how is that possible, but just hearing it, it's very helpful, very helpful. Oh man. Working out too much, or at least a lot, you know, paying the price for it. Well, there's like, again, there's a lot of buttons that are going to be pushed quite soon. To try to generate the requisite intensity that spirit calibrates it and says, I think that this kind of intensity is finally going to work. So spirit has a lot of hope for these times, which is why it talks about the new age, the new world order, the millennium, all this stuff. That's all spirit talk, a hopeful talk that it's finally going to succeed. Now, we don't say it's ego talk because we're beyond that now. We realize it's all spirit. There's no ego doing anything. It's all spirit that's dreaming. The ego isn't dreaming the dream. Spirit's dreaming the dream. There is no ego. There is no such thing as an ego. But it's sort of helpful to use that, sort of take spirit off the hook, like, oh, well, spirit is blameworthy, but this ego, it's really doing terrible stuff. No, there's no situation like that. It's the spirit that's doing terrible, trying to do terrible stuff. It's trying to separate, it's trying to usurp the place of God. It's very arrogant. And we need to repent and say, yeah, that's awful. You know, it's not good. I mean, God doesn't judge us in any way for it. But it's absurd and it's miserable, you know, and it's very arrogant. So we have a spirit. We have to repent, recognize, say, you know, yeah, I'm doing this, but I'm trying to drop doing this. I got to stop doing this. This is you know, not right. It's a mistake. It's not right. And certainly the dreams that spirit is dreaming and the way that it uses dreams are just, you know, horrible for spirit. Horrible. So, spirit has this big hope, you know, that it'll be able to produce enough intensity to generate a new generation who have this transformative ability to transform spirit and change spirit. It's put a lot of its eggs in this basket, and it's been pointing towards these times for a long time. Has a blueprint. It thinks it knows the way to succeed, and so it's on the brink of pushing buttons at this point, figuratively and literally, right? It could end up being a lot of buttons pushed that launch missiles, for instance, and buttons that push that launch other kind of stuff, and the other buttons that cause psychological shifts to take place very rapidly. I've experienced how aggressive women can get, and it's absolutely astonishing, actually. I mean, you just can't believe it. You can't believe it. You know, they can absolutely demand a certain kind of intensity from you, which they believe will produce the children that spirit wants. And that intensity can be very violent, it can be very rough, it can be very, whatever it takes. And so it's like, what? It's amazing. And of course, if you really study the situation carefully, you hear from women themselves all the testimony they've given. They say, yeah, there was a time when that's what I wanted, but now I don't want that now. So guys are always thinking like, what the hell do they want? What's the H-E double tooth fix? One day it's very gentle and romantic, and next day they want to be assaulted, and make it seem like a hideous attack on them to get this unbelievable, fear-based intensity, which they hope then will be transmitted to the child. That will be the transmit, you know, the what will transform spirit. As a bit, it's just like, the women are always changing. What kind of approach that they demand of men. And they were like, what the heck's next? So it's helpful to see what's next, that's for sure. But it's always changing. And if you look back through history, I got this book once, Styles Throughout History. It was mostly female styles, hairstyles and dress styles. It was illustrated, hand illustrated. It's an extraordinary book. I've never seen it since. Went all the way back to Mesopotamian times, ancient Sumer and Egypt, and it went through all the epochs of history and showed the dress and hairstyles and ornamentation styles of the women of the times, and it just absolutely blew my mind. It still would today if I saw the book. I mean, what a tremendous book that was. I think I found it in the library. You just cannot believe the different kinds of changes that have happened throughout history, the way women present themselves. It's just mind-blowing how constantly changing, constantly changing like that. This because nothing works, the spirit has to try something else. And so it's going to try something else in these times now, and it has a lot to do with the intensity. But it's spirit is really all in, virtually all in, almost all in. Most of its eggs are in this basket now. It feels like it just has to produce this new race for the new age, which will have the capacity to transform spirit, transform its creator. The created having the capacity to transform its creator is exactly, of course, what spirit is trying to do with God. So it's trying to finish that loop, finish its own creation, which is to be self-created, to change what it is. So it believes its creation, which is really just its dream figures, will ultimately have the capacity to change what spirit is. But this will never ever happen. So it just keeps going on and on and on and on and on. But spirit's getting tired of this, so it really wants to succeed now. That's why it's going to start pushing a lot of buttons. And really, no man should feel safe at this point on this planet. Because really, men are also just dream figures, and spirit will have them respond and do what spirit tells them to do, like dream figures do what the dreamer tells them to do, unless you're with the Holy Spirit. And when you're the Holy Spirit, you can refuse to obey the spirit, you see. The spirit that's trying to deceive itself, you don't have to obey it. Because the Holy Spirit will dream you, is dreaming you also as a dream figure, the same dream figure, but with a different purpose. You see that? So just because you disobey spirit, so to speak, spirit disobeying itself, doesn't mean your dream figure was going to die, because the Holy Spirit is dreaming a different purpose for the dream. No transformation. No attempt to generate any transformation. In fact, just to accept spirit as it actually is how God created it. So the body and your functioning will remain intact, and you can still function in this world even though you're not going along with spirit trying to deceive itself, that agenda. So it's very important to realize that. Otherwise, we think we'd be annihilated if we don't go along with it. Spirit will just say, well, that dream figure has to die, you know. it's causing troubles. But not without the Holy Spirit, this would take place, actually. But because of the grace of God, it doesn't have to take place at all. You know, I'm sure spirit's not pleased with me one bit, all right? And that's why we think we might die. If we bring all this stuff to light, we think surely we will die. And this is always the feeling. I'm always worried, like maybe I'm going to die. And seriously, that's how I feel. After I tape, I think, I hope I live to see another day, because I'm sure spirit is not happy about me spilling the beans like this. you know, but Holy Spirit protects me. Without that protection, for sure, I'd be a goner. That's been pointed out to me more than a few times. So, one of the way that I have been shown is going to happen is it's going to be a very wild swinging scene. Swinging means really very licentious behavior. Swingers are those who you know, they change partners. You know, if you're married to a wife, your wife goes with other married men, and vice versa, and it's like that. And the whole scene is going to be this wildly swinging scene. Anything goes kind of situation. You know, heedless. Morality, you know, no morality, actually. No morality, just whatever you want to do. And whatever it causes the most intensity, that's what you're supposed to aim for. That's what spirit is wants to aim for. And it will most likely also use war to push all of that. Push all of that, because in wartime, pretty much, you know, anything goes. I mean, women will just, you know, any port in a storm kind of thing, and men too. The idea of marital fidelity and all that kind of goes out the window. It's all about, you know, where's the most intense romance type of thing, right? And war gives a great excuse for that. So the spirit most likely is going to trigger a big, big war. It certainly looks that way, doesn't it? But this is just to help. It's also to get rid of a lot of people on the planet. So the new generation with the supposed transformative abilities, they'll be the only ones here, and it'll be pure. You'll have like a pure race of those. Only those who have this transformative abilities will be able to be on this planet. That's spirit's, you know, dream. But there isn't any dream figure that can change the dreamer. It doesn't matter if you call it indigos or new age children or blah, blah. No. That's all just a dream of spirit. But they want a lot of the older generation. Spirit wants to phase them out. It wants to phase a lot of figures, body figures, out of this world, and it wants just a younger generation to remain who believes we're conceived and brought forth into this world through the right kind of intensity and mindset, so they now have these transformative capabilities, which can then ultimately come back to spirit, and they have the ability to transform spirit. This is a wonderfully helpful way to look at the entire scenario. And you might think, oh my gosh, then we're not really in control whether wars happen or not. No, humans aren't really in control. But spirit, listening to the Holy Spirit, can make a difference in this. They can minimize it all, actually. Remember, just because we don't follow what the Spirit says, Spirit disobeying itself, saying, I don't think I want to do that anymore, doesn't mean that you're phased out. The Holy Spirit will keep you viable here. Okay? And then you can help others listen to the Holy Spirit also. And this begins minimizing the entire impact of the trauma and the intensity that Spirit is wanting to dream. Yep. So we're making fabulous progress right here. In the nick of time, this has been very difficult. It's taken 2 months of summer of intensive effort here to get to this point. Because you're not going to read this. You can't go to some book and read this. You cannot. You will not find it. And I don't have time to write a book. And I do have time, actually. But, you know, what can I say? We're breaking new ground every day here. And it's the pacing of how we're doing it, which is so important. If you put it in a book, it ruins the pacing of it all, right? And you have to actually intuitively pace yourself with the material. But if people just sit down, oh yeah, there's a spiritual book, let me read it. I wrote it in a day. You know, that's not going to help. That's not going to help at all. I spent 15 years with A Course on Miracles. 15 years. And I've spent, you know, 23 years with Journey Beyond Words. 20 years with Sri Sri Anandamaya Ma, for instance. You know, I mean, the pacing of all this stuff is very important. And, you know, you try to just read an entire book, you know, in a day or something with all this information. It's just, you know, forget it. That's just trying to jack up your intensity so you can serve your spirit's purpose, you know. Try and transform, create a transformative generation. That's not the way to do it. So we're not trying to boost everyone's intensity here. You know, we put the intensity all into the wow and just nothing but other than that, and refuse to act on anything. It's just wow is wow, and that's it. We're able to calm down and stay calm about it in this way. Let's see, August, September, October. About 9 months ago, the Holy Spirit got my attention in a very strong way. And I didn't quite know what it was getting at, but it said, I want you to be aware of something. And I said, well, I don't want to be aware. It says, no, I want you got to be aware of this. Some worldly situation. I said, I'm not paying attention to the Holy Spirit. I know that's great, but this one area, you know, it's important that you at least be aware of what's to come, and so it'll help you prepare for it. And ultimately, it turned out to be the Korean situation, which I was unaware of. I really never paid any attention to Korea. Again, we were not taught about the Korean War growing up at all, and it, so I, I know that there's, militaristic, there's hostilities between the North and South, and they don't like each other or something. But that's about it, and the North is just trying to, arm itself better to intimidate the South or whatever. But I didn't really understand what was going on there. Now I do. Now I do. 9 months later, I do. Okay, so it's not. It's wow. What's going on there? Actually, and the more I look at it, and the more informed I become, the more I say, "Uh-oh, holy cow! The Holy Spirit is trying to point something out. It's not good at all, actually. When it comes to, as far as pushing buttons are concerned, that's a major button pusher right there. It's not the only one. It's not the only one. I mean, there's a number of situations. There's the Spratly Islands, South China Sea. There's the northern corridor of India, where China is trying to pinch off northern part of India, building massive infrastructure through Tibetan roads and encroaching on Indian territory. Then there's the Pakistan in Indian situation, and then there's the Middle East, Syria, and it goes on and on and on, and around the world, actually, the very Russia, and it's tense situations. So, there's all these situations where, like, buttons could easily get pushed. So many buttons could get pushed, which would give rise to, like a sudden shift in the world, psychological shift. Spirit will decide, okay, now's the time to go for this, radical intensity. And God knows there's an incredible amount of drugs throughout the world, right? An incredible amount. Methamphetamine is a scourge around the entire globe right now. Cocaine's a scourge. Heroin is a huge scourge throughout the world right now. Opioids are a massive scourge. Painkillers are a massive scourge. And then all the psychotropic drugs are a huge scourge around the world also. There's just an incredible amount of drugs throughout the world, as well as music. Everybody has music now, right? They have it on their smartphones. You can dial in 1,000 stations, every kind of music. So everybody like has portable music wherever they go, easy access to drugs wherever they go. And then you add the sex to that. They have sex, drugs, rock and roll. For everybody, just like a floating party everywhere. Yeah, it's different than before. It's kind of like you can just dial in, a playlist of songs and have an instant party anywhere, and out come the drugs, etc. And this is likely to happen all over the world, all over the world. They're trying to create this new root race and the new age children, children of the new age. It's just all a dream, again, by spirit, trying to do the impossible. Much ado about nothing, absolutely much ado about nothing. But we can see, how, and then it can be shared, all these parties can be shared through, of course, social media. So it amplifies it all, and people can see, oh, this is how they're partying, this is how they're partying, oh, this gives us ideas. And so all these ideas of how to amplify the intensity of your emotional situation, your mental situation, is being constantly shared throughout the world through social media. And this causes just this wildfire of intensity around the world. Wildfire of it. Hello, are we not talking gospel truth right here? When you see it, you just say, "Oh yeah, wow, that's very possible, isn't it?" It's, yeah. Back in the day, we had to rely on like the Berkeley Barb and the, these underground newspapers. If you live near a big city, you had these underground newspapers, and you like try to sneak one, try to find one, and then you like look through it and you try to get some ideas. And they might have like a picture or two of the hippies, dancing in the park or something like. Oh, okay, this is what, how you really let your hair down, get loose, is you wear an Indian headband and some beads, and feather in the headband, and let your hair down. You got long hair, and you kind of, look like this. Oh, okay. And then so we go to the shop, we go to the stores and try to get, this. We wore Indian outfits and stuff, whatever the hippies were doing, the partiers, the ones who were doing this intense partying. Not all hippies were that way, actually. Some of them were very mellow and wonderful, wonderful, trying to be guided by the Holy Spirit. But there were a lot of partiers, okay? A lot. Hard partiers. And so we would look at these underground newspapers, to get ideas and pass them along. So there's all these kind of little pamphlets, you know. Someone might put a flyer for a music, something is happening, a music, a party, and you look at the flyers. How are people dressed? And we used to have people like try to go to these places and take photographs, and they were like really, the ones who took photographs were like really like considered really important, because then they could show the photographs of, look at this costume, or someone was wearing it like this, or this, and this is how it was all passed along at that time. This is how you're supposed to party. But these days, of course, with social media, everyone having smartphones, it's instantaneous. You can access a million parties, you know, nonstop on social media. Of this is what they're doing. You know, there's 10,000 parties in Amsterdam right now, and I can take a look at every single one of them. It's being posted, video and pictures are being posted of it. So it gives you just like almost infinite ideas of how to party. How to party hard. You see, so it can happen instantaneously almost. Back in the 60s, it happened very slow. Someone might see a picture, you know, in the underground newspaper about some, you know, Indian getup or something, and ultimately they'd find it. You know, they have to go to the thrift store and costume shops. Maybe they finally get a hold of something, and they'd wear it, and everyone would go, "What's that?" You know, they'd say, "Oh, this is what the hippies do." "Oh, really?" And maybe, you know, a couple of months later, you might finally be able to come up with something, and maybe you go to the mo buy moccasins. We have to save money to buy a pair of moccasins. We wore moccasins with fringe back then, like we were Indians, you know, Indians, so we could smoke the peace pipe. You know, like the peace pipe, they tried to emulate the Indians, and but it all went very, very slow, very slow. These days, it's going to go like, you know, 10,000 times faster or something, right? I mean, it's just like warp speed of how to party, and getting infinite ideas of how to just absolutely, you know, freak out your mind so you can help bring about. What's that? Something fell. Okay. Bring about the star children, star seed children of the new gener of the new age or something. In all different ways, okay? Massive varieties. You know, forget about it. Forget it. There's nothing to it. There's never been anything to this dream. It's the Holy Spirit that enables us just to see it as it is. But do right practice, and then really drop our utilitarian perception, perspective. We're not seeking how to party, see? We're not seeking, say, oh, this is bring more intensity than this. So we're not trying to induce change in spirit. So everything can seem equal to us and smoothed out, equally beautiful. Nothing to choose from. It's all just this blissful, blissful, peaceful, smooth, indescribable piece of godness. You know, no fluctuation of intensity or anything like that. So that's what ultimately the Holy Spirit gives to spirit who's willing to drop this attempt to change what it is. So we're hearing more and more of this as we, you know, ratchet up the tension and, yeah, our car got wrecked by an Audi, black Audi 4. And it's like, last night I was realizing, wow, we've had so much symbology. I've had so much warning me what's coming, you know, part of what's coming. And hey, North Korea is coming is part of the whole, you know, it's part of the recipe for intensity. It's part of it, just part of it. There's a lot of parts of the recipe. Can't say it's all North Korea. No, it's not. But they certainly are ready to do their part, aren't they? Yeah. Start out with Kim Il-sung, now Kim Jong-il, and Kim Jong-un now. The third one. And the fourth part of Korea is probably going to be the missiles landing. Ballistic missiles landing in various places. And short-range ones, too. That'll get the party cooking, won't it? Absolutely it will. You know, the women will start screaming, oh, survival sex, you know, survival sex, come on, we got to produce the next generation. And, you know, but the intensity, you know, the parties will just become frantic. You know, it's like the Titanic sinking. The more it's sinking, the more they were partying, weren't they? Absolutely they were. Dance faster. Hey, band, play faster. The captain came in and said, you know, I think we're sinking. But he comes to the band and says, hey, band, faster, play faster. Do some kind of Beatles music. Huh? What's that? Well, forget it. Just play faster. When did the Titanic sink? I don't know. 1907 or something. Dance faster. Drink more. You know, like that. Go to your cabins. You know. Survival sex. Reproduce the next generation. The intensity is really strong right now. It might work. It might work. So this is the, you know, it's idiocy. It's complete farce. It's an absolute farce. The universe is a farce. This world is a farce. This dream is a farce. Spirit's dream is an absolute farce, is the best you can say about it. But the Holy Spirit can dream a dream that's not a farce, actually. That's just immeasurably beautiful in every way, and the end of absurdity is more here, feels more here and now than expected. Wow, it's really the end of it. We can just say, I'm experiencing the end of absurdity. Wow, we don't have to say, I have a spiritual enlightenment. Spirit's gonna say, well, yeah, really, okay. Well, but we say, I'm experiencing the end of absurdity. Wow, Spirit, like, and it might say, yeah, wow, that's maybe that's what I can do. I like that. I'm experiencing the end of absurdity. And it feels more here. It feels here and now more than expected. It feels here and now more than expected. The end of absurdity feels here and now more than expected. The end of absurdity feels here and now more than expected. There's a saying, hell hath no fury like a woman scorned. Now we understand why. It's really Spirit that's angry. Spirit says, you know, here's the opportunity to produce the offspring, the effect that can change Spirit, change what I am. And you're not willing to go through with this? This is absolutely, you know, the worst possible disobedience possible. So Spirit gets furious if you don't go along with it. But you just have to hide, you know, behind the Holy Spirit. Say, the Holy Spirit will take care of me. Your fury can't touch me. My own fury can't touch me. There are aspects of Spirit. We're all facets of it. But the facets that are still trying to change what they are, you know, get spiritual facets, get very furious if you don't go along with the program. Now you're hiding behind the Holy Spirit, but they say, yeah, I'm going to get you someday, believe me. No, you're not. I'm permanently hid with the Holy Spirit. And I'm dreaming the end of absurdity. I'm having this dream that's the end of absurdity. And this dream feels more here and now than expected. Wow. I'm having a dream of the end of absurdity. What a beautiful dream it is. What a, you know, it's more here and now than expected. Wow. More here and now. It feels more here and now than expected. Wow. Everybody's spinning the Korean, you know, thing, and I don't need to have it spun because I have a pretty good idea. Holy Spirit has shown me, says, you know, don't be surprised if this is what happens. I say, wow. It's tough to talk about because it's too frightening for people. Everybody wants to have some picture in their mind of it that is not so frightening to them. But what the scenario I see is the most frightening, actually. The Holy Spirit says, you know, it's probably, you need to consider that it may go like this. And I said, wow, that's the worst possible scenario. And said, yeah. But I said, well, okay, you know, let's look at possible that way. And I said, well, I gotta pick up my game then here. I mean, I gotta get more help from the Holy Spirit here. I mean, that's no bueno, you know. That's gonna produce a lot of intensity, isn't it? Holy Spirit said, yeah, it certainly would, yeah, if it plays out that way. It doesn't want to put us on the spot too much and say it is going to play out that way, but it says you should at least be advised that this is, you know, quite possible it could play out this way. And it could play out, you know, in the worst possible way, actually. And everybody's, you know, offering up these, you know, potions like, no, you know what? What we need to do, you know, and need to do this and this and gradually reshape the culture up there and offer amnesty to the folks and eventually change the country from within. Well, I mean, you know, how long is that going to take? You know, 5 years? You know, that may be 5 years too late. You know, they have all these plans like, well, what are you talking about? I mean, we're on the precipice right this instant, actually. Every day they keep telling us, actually, they're more advanced than we thought. It's like, what? Okay. And, you know, are they just going to wait around for a first strike on them? You know, it's probably not, right? Probably not. If you're in their shoes, you know, would you just say, well, we've got all these advanced weapons now, you know, weapons of mass destruction and stuff. And we're just going to kind of sit on them until someone does a first strike on us and destroys them all. You know, are they going to say? Are they think that way? I mean, who would think that way? They might say, "Hey, you know, now that these other countries know that we have all these weapons, they're likely to do a surgical strike and try to take out as many as possible, and we won't even get to use them." So I said, "We might as well use them right now, and get the ball rolling." You know, so yeah. If that's your purpose, is to use them, you know, you might use them first, just to make sure you do use them, get to use them, before someone. I mean, the U.S. got all these, you know, capabilities to maybe take out a lot of those ordinances, and you know, they might be planning to do so. So it's a game of chicken. Who does the first strike? Actually, who does the first strike? We're pretty much in that arena already, because nothing else is working. Those keep saying, you know what, we need to try what has failed the last 15 years. You know, that sounds like the right idea. Well, it probably makes them feel nice and cozy inside for a while, but it's kind of absurd. It's quite absurd. You know, starvation hasn't worked. You know, cutting them off from everything hasn't. Nothing has worked. And they're right at the brink of success now. You really think that they're going to say, oh, you know what? Okay, let's just quit right now. We've been planning revenge for the last 64 years, and that's the only thing we've ever lived for. That's our entire purpose of our civilization. And right on the brink when we're ready to get revenge, we're just going to say, oh, you know what? You know, nah, I think I'll just give it all up. Well, that's a nice pie-in-the-sky fantasy. Yeah, but psychology of spirit is not so much geared that direction for many of us. I might be able to do that, but that's because the Holy Spirit would be in charge of that kind of decision. And, you know, it doesn't seem evident to us that, you know, that they really have put great faith in the Holy Spirit. Nah, it doesn't seem that way, does it? So, I mean, really, come on. I mean, they're button pushers. Let's face it, they are button. They're the chief button pushers of the world at this point. They really know how to push buttons, and they really do. They did in 1950. Total eclipse over Korean Peninsula. On that very day, Kim Il-sung decided, hey, got the go-ahead from Stalin, says, we're going to attack the Americans, South Koreans and Americans, and sneak attack, and they did. Preemptive sneak attack. They didn't see the South Koreans and Americans, didn't see it coming. Did not see it coming. Just suddenly, boom! So, and then they also did a big sneak attack with the Chinese going in the country, launching a massive sneak attack again, and getting the, they got the okay to that. And then Kim Il-sung wanted also later on in the war, when it was a stalemate and there's no way the North Koreans could win the war, he wanted to attack again, full-scale attack again, and Stalin said, we're not going to give you air support, we're not going to back you up, no way. And so he didn't get permission to do that. But he was ready to absolutely do so. They're feisty button pushers in North Korea, actually. You know, they do first strikes. They have a history of it. They do preemptive sneak attacks. That's their psychology. They feel that's probably the best move to make. And it almost worked. They almost captured the entire Korean peninsula. Almost did. So they felt like that somehow they were denied victory there just by cruel fate, you know, the doggone Americans. And so they want to, you know, they think, you know, hey, this time let's give it everything we've got preemptively. Because they know it almost worked before, right? Yeah. They have to understand their psychology, where they're coming from. They have a quite different outlook than most of us are hoping for, actually. And that's why nobody's been able to rein them in. You know, nobody's been able to do it. I mean, China's getting some heat. Say, how come you're not reining them in? And China says, what can we do? You know, cut off this. Or they're not going to stop. It's quite a predicament, isn't it? So that's, you know, the button pushers are getting ready to push the buttons. This is what the Holy Spirit is showing me. It's very likely, very likely. I'm not going to say it will happen for sure. I've certainly been shown a lot of what's likely to happen. And it's, you know, the most intense scenario in history by a long shot. By design. It's all Spirit's dream. It's all... There's nothing in a dream that is self-actuating at all. The dream figures in a dream, the content of a dream, is not self-actuating in the slightest bit. It's all orchestrated by the dreamer. All of it. So they're not some evil North Koreans, you know, about ready to attack the United States or something. That doesn't exist. It's Spirit that's about ready to attack itself. Have one dream figure attack some other dream figure, basically. It's not really attacking itself, but it's trying to produce an atmosphere that will lead to a transformative culture and civilization that will be capable of transforming Spirit. And absolutely it uses drastic measures like nuclear war. Of course, why do you think it's built all these nuclear weapons? One, to put pressure on everybody, scare the heck out of everybody, which it certainly did in the Cold War growing up here in California. I was terrified. You know, I was under just this intense terror that Russians are going to drop atomic bombs on us. Everybody was. But I was a child, you know, I was really susceptible to it. I was like, wow. Every time you hear a plane in the air, you think, oh my God, that could be a Russian bomber. You know, this is the end. The end is here. It's horrible. So that Spirit putting pressure on itself. It's always trying to come up with new ways of pressuring, you know, its dream. You know, plagues of all types. Terrible plagues of all types. Oh my God, you know, here comes this Zika, here comes this virus, you know, it's going to absolutely kill everyone. And sometimes it gets really bad. But the purpose is just to scare the heck out of everybody. All the, give an excuse for the dream figures, you know, to become delirious. Fear and desire go together, really, you know, it's a fact that this emotional state of like death-like fear, just, you know, facing immediate annihilation is really like the ultimate aphrodisiac, actually. It really is. It there's sort of survival instinct that kicks in that just makes you then project that, you know, whatever you see is deliriously attractive to you, you know, irresistibly attractive. Whereas if you were under threat of death, you wouldn't be the slightest bit interested. It's extraordinary. It's like a dream aphrodisiac, so to speak. That's why they have sex and violence always go together in movies and stuff. all brought to you by Spirit's dream, you know, the dreamer, of mixing these two, sex violence, sex violence, sex violence, like this, and then throwing enough drugs there, and yeah, it's a crazy dream, isn't it? It's a crazy dream, but there's a purpose behind it. It's serving Spirit's purpose. Spirit is trying to come up with this new ability that can, you know, that the created transforming the creator. Well, there's no such ability. And of course, Spirit thinks if it comes up with that ability and it's transformed, that means it will be able to transform its creator, which is God. So it's just, the stream is really a way for Spirit to try and ultimately change God and make Spirit the new prime creator. And of course, we are Spirit. We need to repent. It's not like we're good Spirit and there's bad Spirit. We're Spirit. You know, there is the Holy Spirit, which helps us repent. But we have to recognize, yeah, we have been trying to do this. Doesn't work. It'll never work, so there's no harm to it. So there's no reason to feel guilty. We didn't change God. We didn't change ourselves. We can't. So nothing's ever happened. Nothing's ever happened. So, right now, this teaching is going to be given out, because this is where we're at right now. The buttons are about ready to be pushed, maybe sooner than we expect. Certainly, all this is set to coincide with the eclipse across the United States. It's a psychological ploy, all of this. Eclipses, Spirit dreams that they have some effect, psychological effect on the dream figures, such that, as again I said, the Korean War started on the day that this total solar eclipse went across the Korean Peninsula. Korean War started. It was time, the Spirit timed it all, you know, orchestrated it all to be like that. Makes it more ominous, you know, makes it more intense. So this solar eclipse can be utilized to make it all very, very, very intense. And we've got this raging heat spill up in the Pacific Northwest, which is where this eclipse comes on ashore, August 21st. Right now, I guess it's just supposed to get extremely hot up there. Like they say the worst heat wave in history is hitting the Pacific Northwest right now. Well, of course, they're hyping it. But it's supposed to be very, very, very hot up there, which, if, you know, is a psychological issue in itself. It kind of makes everything intense, doesn't it? Yes, it does. And then on the heels of that, I mean, in August, here comes the eclipse across the country, when the rest of the country, you know, the country's probably been broiling in August, right? Just broiling. United States just broiling, just feeling like tons of fear from North Korea, broiling in this heat wave all over the country. The unrest, you know, the hatred, political hatred's going on. People melting down mentally already. So many meltdowns mentally. People are just being reduced to, you know, almost a state of monkeys, the way they're screaming hatred, you know, political hatreds. And here comes this eclipse darkening the land, you know, across the whole continental United States. You know, perfect recipe for the psychology to come unhinged. Perfect psychology for everyone to come unhinged. And this is what's likely to happen. I was almost killed by this door of a truck coming unhinged, this huge container, steel door, like a 6x12 foot solid steel door. It came unlocked, unhinged, and it was swinging wildly. And this signified, you know, the world's going to become unhinged. And it hit my mirror. I thought I just smashed it to pieces and it was broken. And in fact, it didn't break it. I was able to regain my perspective. I was able to snap everything back into place. I said, wow, I dodged a bullet there. That is for sure. It's amazing nothing was broken. It was a miracle. So this was showing me, look, everyone's going to become totally unhinged. And this truck just went rampaging through, hitting other trucks. It was just a rampage. Interesting that inside the truck, it was dark. You know, it may have symbolized the eclipse. The eclipse is going to unhinge the United States. It's going to really psychologically, it's coming at a certain moment to unhinge us. And this is, of course, all the dream of spirit. Doing, you know, what it does when it's desiring to try to change what it is. It doesn't have the desire to change what it is. It can stop, it can relinquish that desire, of course. But it needs the help of the Holy Spirit to do that, really. So turn to the Holy Spirit and just ask help. Ask for protection. Ask for protection. Ask for safety. When this unhinging takes place, you want to be... good thing I wasn't outside of the vehicle, you know. I was still inside. I was protected to some extent. Could have dented the car severely, but at least it wouldn't hurt me. So I was in a safe location. So my perspective took a little bit of a hit, but I was able to snap it back in place, and all was well. I was still able to use the mirror perfectly well, and so I could still see properly, right perspective. But this unhingement that's coming in the world is indeed going to go on the rampage. You just want to stay away from it, right? You want to stay away from it. It's tough. What do? You lock yourself in the house with provisions? That's one idea. Don't even go to the store. Yeah, that's a good idea, actually. Just have a whole bunch of peanut butter and canned soup, and just lock yourself up in the house for, 6 months or something. Don't even go out for work. Of course, you have to pay the bills, and maybe you don't even, I don't know. Pay them through the mail, online or something. I don't know. But you know, how do you just avoid, you know, avoid people, avoid crowds, avoid the unhinged psychology that's like a plague. It's like a plague. It's worse than the Black Plague coming up. It's a psychological plague that's going to take place. So how do you avoid that psychological plague? Well, say, I'd like to avoid that psychological plague. Count me in. You know, I'll do that. It's up to the Holy Spirit, you know, to do it, to help you out. Just like it's up to the Holy Spirit to help me out. And we can't be in the game of trying to please both Spirit and the Holy Spirit, you see. Then that's really unhinging. That leads to oscillation, which is the worst. That's the worst. Leads to suicidal type of feelings if you try to do both. Because then you feel like you don't belong anywhere. There's no hope anywhere. Really, it's terrible. Oscillation is terrible. So, thanks but no thanks. I think I will just ride this out. In a safe way. I will ride this out in a safe way. Everyone should do the same. And err on the side of caution. Err on the side of caution. And there are a lot of steps that we can take, a lot of steps. But, you know, temporarily, you really may want to avoid any interaction with this unhinged psychology, this plague. It's like people took refuge from the Black Plague. You know, they actually moved. They went different places where it wasn't rampaging, if they had the capacity to do so. They took steps of hiding in their homes, etc. And, you know, we have this, you know, the greatest plague in history is about ready to spring upon us. And but the Holy Spirit will deal with it for us, that's for sure. It'll be very interesting to go through this with the protection of the Holy Spirit. Doesn't seem like we have much of a choice, does it, actually? We'll see. You know, we need the whole help of the Holy Spirit. Otherwise, we don't have a prayer. We don't have a chance, really. We'll become, if we don't get the help of the Holy Spirit, we'll become unhinged in some way for sure. That's the dream of spirit. Everybody gets unhinged. Musical chairs. Everybody gets unhinged now, except those who take refuge in the Holy Spirit. And Spirit said, well, I'll cut them off from the new creation. Well, there is no new creation, so there can't be any cut off of anyone. It's all just bluster. Squirrels are dropping wallets all over the place, like buttons pushing, boom, 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 like missiles coming in, boom, boom, boom. And don't think just because you're located a distance from, you know, ground zero, that like, again, I told you, social media will spread everything instantaneously around the world. I don't care where you are. You might be hanging out in Goa on the beach or something. But everybody on the beach has a smartphone. They'll say, oh, did you see this? You say, look at this, look at this. Oh, my gosh, they'll be affected by it. And then they get contagion. And then it's going to spread to you like that. It'll spread around the world like almost instantly. So the shock of that, you know, I don't know how to survive. I will. The Holy Spirit will see to it. But, you know, it's going to be a bit of a startlement, you know, to say the least. Yeah. And who knows how many buttons will be pushed? It may be just continuous. They say for the eclipse will start a 7-year tribulation period, which will end at eclipse about 7 years later. 7 years later, there's another total eclipse across the United States. And interesting enough, it's exactly the number of days it prophesies in the Bible. I don't know, what is it, 1,265 something, two, or I don't know what it is, but it's exactly the days between the two eclipses, I believe, that was prophesied in the Bible, something like that. It all, you know, it adds up to biblical prophecy. And during that 7-year period, the Spirit is going to push as many buttons as it feels it can, right, to try and generate, you know, this new generation of transformational beings, transformational human beings. So, 7 years. 7 years it may go on, button pushing. Whole lot of button pushing. All the party poppers are, you know, going to be pulled. Pull all the strings. A lot of strings being pulled. But we'll take it one step at a time. And more and more protection from the Holy Spirit. More and more protection from the Holy Spirit, right? See, it dreams a dream of us. We are just dream figures. This body, this personality, are nothing but dream figures. I can only speak this way because the Holy Spirit is speaking through me, so to speak, to some extent, right? What I am is just a dream figure. This human person is just a dream figure. That's all. I'm really wow. I'm nothing at all. I'm wow. At least it keeps some little definition for spirit. It's helpful. But so to speak like this, the Holy Spirit has to be dreaming another dream of us. That's a dream of sanity. Dream of sanity, that we know we can't change what we are. And we don't need to keep trying. And so to keep this body communicating and functioning is a type of continuity that helps spirit, helps us, our, you know, spirit, relinquish the attempt to change what it is. It's all great. It's all wonderful. It's all understandable. It's all explainable, really, when we're ready for it at the right pacing. Except the experiencing itself, the dream of the ending of absurdity. It's absurd to think you can turn that into an image. Absurdity is to say that spirit, reality, is an image. So, you know, when you experience the end of absurdity, you're not experiencing an image. Some people say, well, can you, you know, just give us an image of what you're experiencing? Well, you know, the end of absurdity is what I'm experiencing. You know, but you can't give an image. You know, if you make an image, that's right back in absurdity. So dreaming of the end of absurdity is you're not experiencing images. Or you might say you're just experiencing one image, if you want to talk that way. Just one. There's just one image, and it's impossible to fragment it in any way. There's no way you could see any boundaries anywhere, any meaningful boundaries at all. It's like, I gotta take a picture of this. You can't say that. You can't say that. You can't feel that way. You cannot say that anything is more valuable than anything else, or is more beautiful than anything else, or that there is anythingness to isolate in some image. There's no way. It's just all one image, if you want to say it that way. Healed perception. Of course, perception does deal with images. So if you're saying healed perception, it's legitimate to speak in terms of an image, but it's just one image. And there isn't any way to fragment it. To take a picture of it at all would be to deny what you're seeing. It would be absurd. So you see the absolute absurdity of it. And you say, no, I'm getting over absurdity. That's why I'm watching this. I'm not going to engage in absurdity in order to get over it. Holy cow, the squirrels are dropping bombs on us right here. Yeah. That black Audi that rammed us. You got Kim Il-sung, Kim Jong-il, and Kim Jong-un. 1, 2, 3. Then you got the missiles. The fourth stage was an Audi A4. So the fourth stage, and then black Kim Jong-un wears this black, you know, outfits. Always this black kind of suit. He's always wearing that. Looked same color as the Audi that smashed us. Total the car. And a young guy, too, young guy with hair looking not too dissimilar from Kim Jong-un. We call him Kim Kong. Kim Kong. Look out for Kim Kong. He's ready to, Kim Kong is ready to rampage. Go on the rampage. So there's an eerie similarity to the one, the car that, yeah, a real young guy who's actually underage, and I think he had just a learner's permit or something. He shouldn't have been. His dad was letting him drive the car or something without his parent being in the car or something like that. He's on a smartphone, not paying attention, of course, pushing buttons, and boom. And when I came on the scene, and he said, sorry. Like, wow, what a screw up I am, man. But that's the last we saw him. So eerie parallels here. It's like, look out. And it was right near a street that is pretty interesting, name of a street. Getting beaned. It means getting hit in the head, unexpectedly getting hit in the head by a baseball. When a pitcher throws and hits a batter in the head, like, look out, bam, hits him in the head. That's called getting beaned. That's where the accident took place. Pretty amazing, huh? Yeah. I mean, you get a pitcher, you know it's dangerous, but suddenly they lose control, and the ball comes at your head. That's a life and death situation. That's why batters wear batting helmets these days. They didn't used to. It's just baseball caps. And of course, a lot of people got hit in the head, and it wasn't good for them. Still isn't, even with a helmet. So to be forewarned like we are here is very helpful. Gives us a time to say, okay, you know, settle down and say, okay, wow, Holy Spirit, help us out. Being forewarned is very helpful. Being caught by surprise generates maximum intensity of panic, which is what Spirit wants. So Spirit doesn't like those who foretell the future. That's why I was so disliked here. I used to be able to foretell the future effortlessly. But Spirit, here in its dream, didn't like that at one bit. said, shut up. I want people to be surprised and shocked and go into panic by what happens. I said, but that hurts their mental psych, that hurts their psychology, that hurts their awareness of spirit. You know, that's not good. Let me tell them what's going to happen so they're aware of it ahead of time and can make the right adjustments. And spirit said, no. You know, that's evil to do that. That's not right. That's against the laws of nature. You can't do that. You know, it's horrible. So I stopped doing it, you know. But I used to be just like infallible about it. I just was aware. It was just awareness. I just knew what was going to happen. Wherever I was, I knew what was coming, what was going to happen. And short term, even long term. Getting hit by rocks, pretty close thing to getting hit by rock it. Rocks coming down on us, rock it's coming down on us. Interesting. There's this big, the dream I had, this huge rock, the slab, a huge rock, and it broke into a whole bunch of rock, smaller rocks. Could you not call those smaller rocks rockets? Et, meaning kind of diminutive, a diminutive. Rockets, rockets. Wow. And it landed on what? Highway 111. Which would, World War III. A restraint suddenly broke, a restraining situation, a bank is something that restrains the rocks from falling. Suddenly it collapsed, so some sort of resolve that held the rock in place collapsed, and this whole side of the mountain came down. But as it came down, it broke into all sorts of rocks, plural, rockets, rockets, R-O-C-K-E-T-S, and hit. Dream was in the United States, and everyone was absolutely shocked and stunned to an extraordinary extent. They couldn't believe it. And I was able to escape it. I was aware, you know, sort of aware in advance of the general overall scenario. I somehow was able to escape it. Had to flee, yeah, to a reduced intensity zone, Arizona, so to speak, a reduced intensity zone, where the intensity of it wasn't so severe. Rockets, the first time I've seen that, rockets, missiles, call them missiles, call them rockets. Suddenly, without warning, massive amount. This is history. Look at the history of the world. Sudden warfare is the history of the world. You know, Hannibal suddenly pounces on Italy. You know, I mean, it's just throughout history, armies on the march set up, and suddenly they make their move at the most auspicious time. They don't announce their intentions ahead of time. They want shock and awe, as much as possible. But the U.S. with Iraq, shock and awe, right? Wasn't that shock and awe? Just suddenly, you know, try to shock and awe the other side. That's how it works. The ancients, with some wisdom, with some grace of God, they tried to lessen that by saying, okay, we want to take over your territory, you want to take over ours. Okay, fine. All right, now we're going to choose a champion from our warriors, and you choose a champion from your warriors, and we'll meet at this particular date, and they'll have a fight to the death, and whoever wins, the winner gets the loser's territory. And they handshake, we all agree, and, you know, exchange gifts and say, okay, we'll do it this way. So there was, you know, wasn't much shock and awe. They sat there watching the contest, and then it was over, and they said, okay, well, now we're your slaves. So it was done differently. Occasionally it was done differently, There are times when it's done like that. And then in chivalry in the Middle Ages, you know, okay, here's the knight, you know, and we'll joust and like that, set up in a nice situation. And, you know, very chivalrous, all sorts of manners and niceties and fair play and this and that. Oh, he broke his lance, give him another one, you know. And whoever gets knocked from the horse, they're the loser, okay. Trying to minimize this whole, you know, this whole situation. But right now, you know, it looks like shock and awe is the order of the day. Had a really weird dream last night. All these vehicles, like they're like kind of whitish vans, they were going past this place I was at on the road, and they all had this string rope from the back of the van to the front of the other van bumper, and in the middle of this rope between the two was a white flag. And there's just a huge parade of these vehicles just going by. It seemed to go on for so long, so long, so long, so long. It's like, you know, peace, peace, we surrender. You know, no fighting, no fighting. You know, white flag in war means we're ceasing, no hostilities here. We're not, no hostile intent here. And then suddenly, that parade of vans with white flags ended. And something got through to me, and some people came rushing up to me, as pointing something out. So that dream would say, look, we've been in this time where everyone said peace, 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 no hostilities. Okay, yeah, we're not going to do anything hostile. You know, we're waving the white flag, no hostilities here, and we think, oh, you know, yeah, no troubles, no trouble. And suddenly, oops, no more white flags. Uh-oh. Here comes the button. Here comes spirit pushing the buttons. So it's useless to tell spirit, hey, spirit, don't push the buttons. Come on. We're nice people here. Spirit says, well, what are you talking about? You're not nice. I created you to be transformative towards me, and you haven't done that. That's not nice. You're being disobedient to me. And you got to be successful at that. So I got to, you know, push the buttons so that you'll succeed. And once you succeed, then everything will be perfect for you. But you do have to succeed, so here come the button, pushing button. So it's useless to try to dissuade spirit in that way. You just have to go to the Holy Spirit and say, Holy Spirit, you know, my life is in your hands. My dream is in your hands. Now, it should be nice to feel the safety that brings. Allow ourselves to feel that safety. Allow ourselves to feel that safety. Those who go through that, they're still, you know, basically aspects of spirit who are still trying to transform what they are, change what they are. So the suffering they go through, they think it'll be transformative. No, suffering is not transformative. Not at all. And when you finally see that, you say, oh, man. So all this time I've been suffering so bad, and it didn't do anything. It'll never do anything. Right. Oh, my gosh. Okay. Well, let's work on putting an end to that then. What else is there to do? Radio Free Holy Spirit here, right? Kind of like that, isn't it? Maybe you can have this on your radio dial. You can just play this, rip it to an MP3 and play it on your MP3 player. Just play it off, you know, audio off your smartphone, right? Even though I say don't have a smartphone. That's the worst drug possible, because you'll be really tempted to use it and to check out, you know, check out the conflicts, check out the parties, the marches, the protests, the intensity, check out the intensity all the place. And God said to me, you want, in order to be saved, don't check out the intensity. Forget about it. So just say, thank you, Holy Spirit, and stay in a very calm, very sedate, out of the way place. That's just, as Longchamp said, go to the wild woods. Very calm, sedate place, away from the intensities. You know, let the intensity be trying to make a putt. You know, oh, I missed it. You know, like, oh, just slipped out there. Okay, let me tap it in. That was intense. Here comes a chip. Let me chip it so I can get it close. 3 feet away. That's pretty good. Pretty good chip there. And just let that be the intensity. I know you're not being like Mr. Superhero, you know, being transformative. But that's all utter delusion. Yep. So maybe I should take a nap. I can't. I wake up at 4 a.m. My back is just, lower back is just killing me. I mean, it's just the whole, because I just overdid it so much, and it's just, I get numb in my shoulders and arms, and I'm just feeling, wow, again, I overdid it. It's kind of the nervousness of the times. I just gotta, you know, stop swinging. Okay, no more swinging of the clubs. No more, but it's fun to do it, but no more swinging. I don't know what I'll do. I better jog is what I'll do. On a trampoline. It's just easy jogging. Doesn't seem to hurt my knee. So, very intense video. It's a time for super intense videos, isn't it? But at the same time, we're saying, hey, this is quite interesting, actually. And, you know, maybe there's some that will duck out at this time. They ducked out. It's okay. Give a little chance for everyone to duck out who wants to and say, wow, maybe this is too intense. But for those of you who are still hanging in there, you may be seeing like, hey, this is like really helpful, actually. Holy Spirit, I put my dream in your hands. You do the dreaming of what I am. And hey, I'm dreaming the end of absurdity. Clearer, I mean, it's nearer. It feels nearer, and it feels here and now more than expected. Another walnut being dropped. It feels here and now more than expected. Walnuts everywhere. Boom, boom, boom. Boy, they're making a mess of it. Why the heck they drop it? What, they can't keep them in their hands? They keep dropping ones that they haven't eaten. They're very slappy squirrels, you know. Man, just raining walnut pieces down here. little ant. Move along. A lot of people will check out. Older people, they'll have some sort of medical procedure, and oops, didn't work so well. Check out that way. Because they don't want to, you know, their ideals are just too, you know, like, oh my gosh, I can't get with the intensity. I'm a loser. Hurry up, I got to be born. Maybe I'll be one of the babies, born a new age baby. Yeah, so the time to check out, I'll be a new age baby, one of the transformative babies. That's what they're probably going to do. Spirit telling them that, you got the opportunity, let's go. Spirit just telling itself that. It's all spirit doing the dreaming, of course, but acting as if it's some sort of entity, a dream entity. So, yeah. Time to check out and check back in. And you may be the year, I got a feeling you're going to be the one who's transformative. I'm telling you that. Oh, really? Oh, wow, that's amazing. That's great. I'm so happy to be able to do that for you, Spirit. Yeah. Next thing you know, you imagine that, oh, you're a baby again. In the post-apocalyptic world. With the burden of transforming spirit upon you. Good luck doing that. Oops. Failed again. Oh my gosh, what a catastrophe. How could you possibly fail? You had every possibility to succeed, you still failed. A horrible person. That's terrible. Inner conflict, inner shame, inner despair, all that stuff, mental health problems. Welcome to the new age of severe mental health problems. So, you know, different ways of talking styles come up during different different area, parts of the dream or time frames of the dream. So right now, 217 here, summer 217, is a very different epic right now than other previous times. You know, it's really very unprecedented. It's very, very different right now. We're realizing that, aren't we? Say, oh my gosh, the world truly is extraordinarily different than it just was just a little while ago, actually. And it's accelerated so fast that 20, 30 years ago, I mean, it might as well have been some other world and some other universe almost. The change has been so much. And what we're facing right now, we're facing nuclear holocaust, way more dangerous than the Cuban Missile Crisis. The last really dangerous crisis might have been said the Cuban Missile Crisis, when Kennedy said we're going to destroy those bases you put them in there, and they both kind of blinked because Kennedy made a deal with Russia, some kind of really important deal that they'd allow Russia to take over something. I don't know what it was, but it was a pretty big concession. Khrushchev got that. And Kennedy got the missiles taken out of Cuba. But we were on the brink of nuclear war, really, with the United States and Russia at that point. I think it was 1962-ish, I think. So that was really nerve-wracking, to say the least. I was like 6 years old, and I remember, Kennedy getting shot when I was about, 7 years old or something like that. It was horrible. I said, uh-oh. Things are never going to be the same. Now you can feel it. That's a button. That was a button pusher right there, big one, really big one. But just business as usual, right? In this dream, always there are buttons being pushed, so many. But the apocalypse, they all get pushed. The whole circus is in town. At least that's the way that Spirit has planned it. But of course, if we put our dream in the hands of the Holy Spirit, this does have changes the equation, changes the recipe. Spirit has to adjust to that, actually. Spirit has to say, everything's changed suddenly. Something's a little different. I didn't expect this, So it does change the equation. So, predicting the future is difficult because if we are aware of what Spirit is going to do, and then we put our dream in the hands in the Holy Spirit, that drastically changes really the equation for Spirit. And Spirit might have to say, well, wait a minute, this was definitely what I was going to do, but now I better make some adjustments to that because everything's a bit out of whack. So that's why, to prophesize the future, sometimes, it can have a very helpful effect to lessen difficulties, often. Something similar might happen, but maybe the intensity is, everything has been tweaked, Spirit has tweaked its dream. And it's had to back off a lot of stuff that it would like to have done. Because it says, I can't sure what's going to happen now because there are those who don't seem to follow the way I tell them. The dream figures, I say, do this, and they don't do that. And yet I tell them, okay, you got to disappear, dream figures, and they don't disappear. Now, what the heck's going on here? I better figure out what's going on here. This is worrisome. Yeah, the Spirit wants to make dream figures disappear, but the Holy Spirit says, "No, I want you around. It's a helpful communication device, so you're not going to disappear." Oh. got home, had a veggie burger about 4 o'clock, and that's it. Won't eat again till the morning time. So that's one way to keep your weight down. I probably eat, you know, during like a small window of time. I'm really cutting it off about 4 o'clock these days. Maybe I'll have a smoothie of some type, you know, a little protein smoothie later on, but, you know, not many calories at all. And keeping the weight, keeping it down pretty well. I'm a little bit over, but close. I need to get down a little further, but I keep, you know, you keep bouncing back up. I do at least a couple pounds, and you know, you stop eating hardly anything, and you know, you lose a few, then you eat something, you go back. It's like that. So we've done an intense workout here, and at some point you rest. It's like, at some point maybe I'll just say, you know, let's take a little break here and really recuperate. Like sometimes you work out really intensely for a week or so, you need to take like a week off, you know, just recuperate. Wow. So who knows? I might do that. Could be a good idea at this point. Let everyone catch up on the videos. And this is, you know, information that helps prepare us psychologically. Put your life, put your dream life in the hands of the Holy Spirit as much as you can. Trust as much as you can. I'm going to try that. It's called leaning on the everlasting arms. The Christians have names for it because some have, you know, done that. They turn their lives over. They say turn their lives over to Jesus. Really, turn your life over to the Holy Spirit. Turn your dream life. Turn your dream, what you are, just a dream. Turn your dream over to the Holy Spirit. Your dream life over to the Holy Spirit. Wow. Fantastic. And then experience the dream of the ending of absurdity, which is feels more here and now than expected. Wow. Wow, 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 wow. Gotta be about 92 today. Feels just normal. There's just 92 doesn't feel like anything abnormal at this point here. Doesn't really feel hot. It just feels warm at this point. You get used to it. It's actually a cool, nice little cool, refreshing breeze, which really helps a lot. We'll see what tomorrow's like. It's supposed to be a scorcher. I'll go check the weather. Yes, you know, just scorching hot in the Pacific Northwest, that's for sure. Probably hyped a lot, but could be a warm one. Where I am, I don't know how it is where you are. It could be warm there too if it's summer. Intense, right? Intense. So, what day is today? Today. So you'll be watching this video on the 1st of August, right? Well, here we go with August, right? August, 21 days to the eclipse. So we're really counting down the days at this point. And Holy Spirit, you know, wow, time to put our dream in your hands completely. Into my hands I commend my dream spirit, Holy Spirit, right? My dream spirit, my quote-unquote soul, my dream spirit, which is just a figment, just a dream that spirit is dreaming. So I commend my dream experience into your hands, Holy Spirit, into your arms, so to speak. Put myself into your care. Now you're in charge of dreaming my dream experience. Wow, what a powerful idea that this is. Are the Giants still playing? I don't know. If you're like 32 games out of first place, can't you give mercy rule and you have to stop playing? What? No? Wow, I don't know. Maybe they should just call it a season at this point. That's it. Got better things to do. hang out with Brian Wilson and learn to throw a knuckleball. Come on. That might help him. So many home runs being hit, maybe you need to start throwing knuckleballs. It's hard to hit a home run off a knuckleball. You're not displaying any power. It's like throwing a butterfly up there. It drives the big hitters crazy because they want it like a 100 mile an hour fastball. All they got to do is turn on it, get the sweet spot, and it's gone. You know, they get airborne, backspin, it's gone. Pitcher's finding the power 100 miles an hour. Throw a knuckleball at like 50 miles an hour, you know, something. It's like, you know, it's just fluttering around erratically. It's hard to hit that one. Messes up your swing. So, I never threw a knuckleball. I never could throw one. I threw a great knuckle curveball. Awesome one. But never could throw a knuckleball. I'm not sure. I never was sure how to do it. I never really focused on it enough, I guess, to learn how to throw a knuckleball. I should have, but the knuckle curve was amazing enough. That was an even more exotic pitch because I could control it. Which way it broke, depending on how I put spin on my fingers, just flicked my fingers on my knuckles, I could more of this finger, the spin going this way, the spin going this way. And it was just an absolutely unhittable pitch. Whereas a knuckleball, you can't really control it. Don't know where it's going. So, again, we put our dream life in the care of the Holy Spirit. Say, Holy Spirit, you dream our dream now. Instead of Spirit, you dream it. Now, Holy Spirit is Spirit, but it's Spirit blessed by God. So, blessed in a particular way to deal with this silliness that Spirit is trying to change what it is. So, the Holy Spirit is created to dream a new dream for us, a restorative dream, a beautiful dream. So let the Holy Spirit be the one that's dreaming our dream now. Let the Holy Spirit be the one that's dreaming our dream. A dream of the ending of absurdity. Oh, how nice this ending of absurdity is, how wonderful it is. More, feels more here and now than expected. Wow, 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 wow. All right, oh, very great. Holy Spirit, you do the dreaming of me now. All right, you do the dreaming of me now. You do the dreaming of me now, Holy Spirit. And that's it. That's all we need.